Well, welcome back again to our topic, talking about school. As our Zoom meeting finished, we had to stop very quickly, but we will continue now. So, Linda, did you study hard at school?
I did sometime. Some other time I didn't. By high school we had the final exam. If we succeed to this exam, we go to university. Otherwise, we finish school or we just have to pass it again. So for this year, I remember that I studied hard. But before, I was like a normal student, not studying always hard. But I had good marks anyway.
Right. But for example, in the classroom, did you talk while the teacher was explaining?
No. I was very calm.
Right. So you behaved well.
Student. Yeah, right. I behaved well. Yeah.
So you behaved well, just that we understand you didn't push yourself to the limit in your studies till the last year when it was very important.
Yeah, but also I had some special conditions. I lived in a village. Sometimes I go by foot and I come back home by foot, and I have to walk through very high hills, and it wasn't so easy to study at school and study at home. And when I'm at home, I am like washed out and I just need to sleep.
Right, so when you finally got home, you were washed out, you were tired, and so you just didn't feel like it. And so sometimes you had to go on foot or walk, and so that made studying that little bit harder. Not because, as you were saying, you were exhausted just from traveling there and back to school. So we know of many people who have this difficulty, and you were one of them at that time, no? That made it a little bit harder.
Yes.
Right. Selma, let's see what your question is. Did you do your homework after school, or did you daydream? Love it. So did you daydream? Do you understand that? That you were like thinking about other things and not concentrating, or did you do your homework? Selma, you need to unmute yourself.
Sorry. I did my homework after school. Every because I was a good student.
Well done.
Right. So there are lots of students who daydream. Daydream is sit there like that, looking at the ceiling or out the window, and you don't do your homework. And you, Ellen, did you do your homework or did you daydream? Alan, did you do your homework?
Well, I'll be quite honest. We weren't given homework. This was a different era. Can you believe that? I mean, children today are swallowed up with homework. They do as much homework, it seems to me, lessons in their home as they do at the school. But we didn't have any of that in my era. It's rather sad, really. No wonder I was so far behind. I wasn't particularly an intellectual anyway.
No, but if you look in the rules and regulations, I think that it's illegal to send homework, in the sense that you shouldn't send homework home, or a very little amount. They're supposed to do it at school. But
I didn't know that, but we just didn't have any homework.
Yes.
Quite the opposite to today.
Well, my little grandson, he's 7. And he has homework every day.
I think it's too much these days. I really do.
They get overwhelmed, no? So, for example, where I am, I only talk where I am. We have, I think it's called intensive, in the sense all the school hours are before lunch. So they go to school at 8 o'clock in the morning and they finish at 3. But then the teachers send home a lot of homework for all afternoon.
All the marking. Yeah.
So what parents need to do, as they are working or tired or they don't know, they send them to private classes. So it's big business private classes where they do their homework all afternoon. So as you said, when I listen to my students, my teenagers, I feel sorry for them sometimes because they're not living life, because they are so overwhelmed with their studies. So at your time, you didn't do homework. I did very little. I did like a project or something like that, but not a lot. Not the same amount as they do now, which is all afternoon, the weekends. I don't think they do anything else really, only do the homework. Yeah, it's quite amazing how much homework they get and how they have to stay at private classes. Right, Linda, do you have, did you have a teacher who inspired you to continue studying his subject? So first question, did you have a teacher who inspired you in his subject?
Sorry, I have some noises I need to
Then I will ask Salma. Salma, did one of your teachers inspire you at school? Were you lucky enough? In what subject was it?
I had a teacher who inspired me in the in the university, and I started after a few years to teach her subject in the university too.
Right, and what subject was it?
It's I don't know how to say econometry.
Economics. So it could be economics, business study, depends on the specialty. So your teacher at university inspired you when she was teaching you economics, and then you finally went on to do the same. Is that correct?
Exactly. It's statistics. It's statistics for economists.
So your economics teacher inspired you, and you followed in her footsteps. You followed in her footsteps, and you did the same thing. What about you, Alan? Did you have any inspiration at school from a teacher?
Not from secondary school. Things really started to change for me when I went on to, technical college, where I was now learning my trade. And the lecturer, not lecturer, the teacher was known in those days. He inspired me to go into, he was such a good teacher, the way he put things over. I wanted his job, basically. I thought that that's what I want to do for a living. And but my trade, of course, was in construction, in the water industry, and we were all taught about plumbing. We call it plumbing. I don't know whether you're
plumbing.
Plumbing and heating.
Right.
It's a joint industry, really. But yes, that's where I really got my act together, and I did study hard, and I did have homework, and it turned the tables for me, and I got my qualifications and went on from there on, due to the inspiration of my teacher or lecturer, as we call them.
So for our viewers, a plumber is someone who solves our problems when it has to do with water and pipes. Very simply explaining. But I imagine you studied this to a high level. And heating are the things that helps to keep us warm. And normally it's a machine, no? You could say it's a machine, a heater. And so you studied the systems of keeping us warm with a heating system, or how to solve water problems of pipes and different things like that.
That's right.
Okay, so now we've got Linda back. And Linda, we've finished the conversation, but I'm going to ask you, all the same, did you have a teacher who inspired you?
Yes, middle school, I had my English teacher. She was a nice teacher. And like with us, she was nice with all pupils, and I liked the language because of her. And in secondary school, it was my mathematics teacher, and I was in a mathematics class, and that's why maybe I learned computer science and I learned accounting also.
So mathematics was in secondary, and maybe because of that you became an accountant.
Yes, I became first IT engineer, then I studied in a private school accounting. So at university, I'm an IT engineer.
Right, so it has to do with mathematics, no? One way or another, no?
Yes.
Now, I'm going to be deeper. For example, you said you liked your English teacher. Did she teach you anything, or she was just a nice person?
Yeah, of course, she was a good teacher. My first English words I learned with her.
Oh, right.
Yeah. Right. And I'm trying to get to it because my students confuse, I think, sometimes a good teacher with a friend. And for me, a good teacher isn't your friend. It's other qualities. So this is what I'm trying to get to. And your math teacher, why did your math teacher inspire you?
I had some difficulties with mathematics before, and I solved my problem. I got more knowledge, and I liked mathematics because of this teacher, because he made this topic easier for me.
Right, so a topic which was out of your reach, it was out of your reach, because you couldn't understand it, it was difficult for you. He broke it down so you could understand and you could identify more with the subject, I think.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So, okay, so maybe he did his explaining in a down-to-earth way, so he was on the same level as you, so you could understand him, no? Mm.
For my English teacher, she wasn't like a friend, and at my time we don't have our teacher as a friend. There is only respect between us, but there is I don't know if I can say a correct teacher. They are correct with all of us, they don't make difference between pupils, and this is what I liked with this teacher. She don't make any difference. We are all equal.
Right. So she didn't distinguish between one and another.
Exactly.
Right. Exactly. Last week we learned a word with Lily. Do you remember teacher's pet?
Oh yeah.
Teacher's pet. So you're saying that your teacher didn't have any teacher's pets. They were no distinction between everybody, and everyone was the same, which you really liked about her. So Selma, continuing with this just a little bit more, you said you liked your economics teacher, and can you explain why?
Oh, she was intelligent. And in the university, it's different because some people doesn't don't like the subject and
they don't take it seriously.
Don't respect the teacher, no, because you are adult, and they she brings the subject. It's not a easy subject in a soft way.
I'm saying before, I had a math teacher, and I believe he was very intelligent in the sense of his degree, his certificates, and everything he had. But he wasn't able to connect to us.
Mm-hmm. No personality.
He didn't connect in the way of explaining.
So
because he used to say, you're not asking any questions, and we said to him, one of us was brave enough and we answered, sir, we don't understand what you're saying. So there is an expression to talk over somebody's head.
So
he was so intellectual, if you want to say it this way, he couldn't connect with us to explain on our level.
Selma, can I ask you, a university, am I right in saying, I've never been to university, but I just have visions of you all sitting there in your desks or these tiered benches, if you like, and the lecturer spouting out all this information, Do you, is it more or less, am I right in saying probably 95% is the lecturer talking and you just sit and listen and take notes? Do the students get the opportunity to ask questions? And if so, how often does that happen?
Oh, I think it's very, nowadays it's not common because my sons studied in the university.
Yes.
And they say that it's more difficult because people, the teachers put the subject and
yes.
you have to look it for in the online and there are many things. But in my when I studied, it was different. teachers, of course, there are bad and good teachers, and I had the opportunity to have this teacher is very it's amazing because she teaches with passion, and it's different when people.
So am I right in the way then that a lot of it is down to the student to take notes, and when they get home is to study books or texts that will give them the answers. The actual lecturer doesn't, I mean, he's giving you all this information as I see it, and it's down to you to absorb it and make notes. Would I be right in saying that?
So for example, Selma, when you were at university with this teacher that you liked, did she do all the talking or were you allowed to ask questions?
Yes. And I have the opportunity to ask questions and to write down, and it's no problem. But I think the students most of the time, the students need it's the how does the student study, you know?
Yeah.
I think. Because I always wrote down, I make notes,
yeah,
and ask something if I don't understand. It depends on the teacher to give you or no the answers, you know? My son didn't wrote anything because
right,
only to pay attention in the class and absorbing the content.
Yes.
But I think it's different.
Different method. No, because when we've seen a film, Selma, of university, so still films can be true or false, we see a teacher at the front of the class and he's going duh, 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 and he's talking for an hour, 2 hours.
Non-stop. That's right.
Non-stop. The people are non-stop. Sat there like this. If they want to write, they write. And if they don't, they don't. And he says, hello, talks for 2 hours and bye-bye. And he has no connection with the student. This is the impression we have. Because of the films we have seen.
Yeah.
In reality, we don't know. In reality, we don't know if this is true or not.
Can I say something?
Yes,
yeah,
of
sure.
course.
Yeah. Yeah, sorry, because for my time, it's on the, I was in university in 2000, and we have this big room with all these benches. We are more than 100 person inside, and the teacher is speaking for maybe more than 1 hour and a half. And we even if we ask, they don't really answer. They ask, they answer that you are a student now, you have to do your own research.
Oh.
You have to search in the books, you know? And fortunately, we have for each topic, we have a special lesson in a classroom. They divide us into small groups of maybe 20. And in this class, we have the opportunity to ask, but with another teacher.
Ah.
We have two teachers for the same topic. One for this, to do exercises and ask questions, and the other one in the big room, like to teach us like the theoretical lesson, and we don't really catch anything from my experience.
Yeah, so this is what Alan gets the impression. This is the impression Alan gets, that the teacher stood there as they're talking to himself, like a parrot, and then you said you had another class for questions and answers. So at least you had another class with questions and answers. Once I saw a man, he just, I was with somebody and it was online, but the man just started to talk and he never took breath. He didn't go like that. He didn't do anything. He just went, boo, 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 boo. And I was thinking,
terrible.
So I wouldn't be inspired to go to university. Just someone stood at the front and off he goes. And when he finishes, he goes, bye and see you next week or tomorrow, or whenever. You were lucky, Linda. At least you had another class where you could ask your questions if you didn't understand. So I don't know, sometimes, for example, I know when I've gone to Morocco that there are hundreds of people in the classes in university and they sit up on the steps, so can imagine the rows like that. And like then they sit up on the steps.
It's called auditorium.
Okay. So they're all sat there, hundreds of people. I don't know how many, could be 200. And as there are not enough chairs, they sit up the side, up on the steps, and they just want to listen to the teacher. And I don't know if they take the register. I don't know if they go, Alan, present, Selma, present, Linda, present. I don't know if they do that or not.
I don't know.
So it's another world. I think we've come to a conclusion that university is another world, and you have to defend for yourself.
Well, I can only assume that if you've come through sixth form college or whatever, that you're intelligent enough to be able to do this for yourself, because the onus is on you, it seems to me, once you go to university. They're just giving you information, and it's up to you to absorb it and... make notes. And I assume when you get back to the dormitory, you discuss this with your colleagues. I mean, I'm sure there must be a lot. What did you make of Mr. So and so's question, whatever?
And but so sometimes in the dormitory, in your bedroom, if you're sharing, they're studying another career. They're not studying the same one.
Yes.
So, for example, Linda was studying engineering and Salma is studying economics. So they could share the same room, but they have different subjects. But I think it's a frightening moment, Alan, for people, because I always listen to stories here and the teachers help them pass the exams. The teacher helps them get good marks so they can go to university. But they are false in the sense that they're not as clever as their marks reflect. And also, as they've been spoon-fed at school, they are not used to doing work by themselves.
Yes.
So it gets quite frightening, leaving home, being in a different situation, and never being shown how to study or how to work by themselves. Because they would have a teacher to spoon feed them, they would have private classes. So they've been given everything. So they've never been able to work by themselves.
And nowadays teachers from university, they are telling the like the students, if you want to understand, come to my private school.
Oh yes, I remember that one. So they do a thing in the sense of they get business from the state school. You haven't understood my class, well, you know what to do, come to my private classes. And we can't speak for everybody. But there are teachers, if you don't go to their private classes, they don't give you good marks. I'm sorry, Linda, I know all the negative things. but there are teachers who take advantage of their profession, and you go to university and you're in their class. And they said, if anyone needs help, come to my private classes. Linda said that. And I know that if you don't go to their private classes and pay them that extra money, you don't get the marks.
Oh my gosh.
Yes.
So there are all kinds of things. So it depends in which country you are, in which system. In some countries, there are no resources. So it's like a different ball game. Depends where you are. Okay.
It strikes me that the English taught in universities is not good at all. For those that I've spoken to, you know, I say, do you take English at the university? They say, yes. And I'm thinking, well, you know, for quite an intellectual student, the tuition they're getting on English is very poor. It really is.
But what kind of English are they learning? Are they learning theory and never practicing a word of communication?
Well, it's a combination probably of both. Mm-hmm. Yes, I don't know. Yes, yes.
So if it depends on so many things, if they're just doing theory and they've never spoken a word, for example, I have heard of people that they have been studying English for so long, theory, the traditional method, and they don't get to speak till they're 18, 21 like that. And then it's very late.
Many times. Yes. Yes. And still can't speak the language. I'm surprised they don't have an English teacher. Somebody from UK to teach English so that they hear the pronunciation and all that goes with it.
But they are called, I can't remember now, something called assistant. So there were, before the pandemic, there were some people that did their practical experience, and they used to be with the Spanish teacher in the English class, and they gave conversation. So not everybody, but some classes got that. Yeah. Right then, everybody. So today we talk about school, about university, and we give our own little impression about that. So let's say goodbye, and we'll see each other in another meeting. Okay,
thank
then.
You so much.
Bye.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.